take about 2 hours, and we may have a break between the model and the data part. And after that, we have a field trip to practice the model.
Registration evaluation. So, yeah, we sometimes you see referred to as RegEval. You see that kind of a shortened form a lot. That's just what it is. And why do we do it? Well, basically, based on the Food and Ag Code, we're supposed to take into consideration ecological effects, and it's pretty much mandated. Our registration process here in the department has a CEQA equivalency. That's the California Environmental Quality Act. So basically, what we do is equivalent to like an environmental impact report, right? That's kind of like the idea. So that's why we're doing this. It's also an ideal opportunity for us to protect surface water. And this is the prevention part. This is the prevention part of our program. We have basically prevention and we have responsive. This is the part where we could really try to make a difference before we let materials or pesticide products come onto the market and get used. And the idea is that we're here to prevent significant adverse effects. That's according to our mandate. You'll see that come up periodically, significant adverse effects. It's implying that there's some level of insignificant adverse effects, that it could be some non-target, you know, impact, but that's okay for FIFRA and that code. But just keep that in mind when you're doing your reviews, and you'll see this pop up occasionally in the talk today. In some cases, even when we have the registration, we grant registration for products, for example, conditional or even regular full support or Section 3 registration, the process gives us an idea of what to look out for, mainly the watch list. So if something's conditional, it goes onto the watch list. We'll keep an eye on that. It can come up on our monitoring prioritization later on. And we'll be on it already. We'll keep an eye on these things. So we know it's coming. We'll have to fix it. I'll mention that later. We'll talk about that later. US EPA does a similar review at a federal level, because that has to be pesticide has to register that the EPA at the federal level first, or concurrently. But we are California-centric, so we're reviewing for California. Sometimes US EPA may not catch certain things, and they'll say, well, we were reviewing for the entire nation and not necessarily looking at the conditions of California. We were very specific. We have very unique traits here. For example, whether it's the non-target organisms that are out there, whether it has to do with like the housing density, the way the landscape is really designed around and also built around urban areas in California is very unique compared to other parts of the nation. There's uniqueness to the water bodies that are that receive the runoff or drift. Ina's actually working on a model to look at a more refined receiving water for the state that would be a link to our evaluation. Okay, what is it? Well, it's a scientific review, of relevant data, we know that, to determine the use of the active ingredient and or its resulting degradants will result in significant adverse effects to aquatic life in the state. Nutshell, okay? You get lost, just think about that's what this is. There's a lot of stations that review this. We're not the only one that do reviews here. There are stations within registration branch, MedFox review for their own, to fulfill their branch mission. Work of Health and Safety. Well, they probably changed names already. It's not MedSox anymore. What is it? Human Health
Assessment?
Yeah. So we're not the only one. Even within our branch, we have air, we have groundwater reviews too. This is important. Well, when we finish our registration evaluation, we come up with recommendations. We don't make the decision to say this is the way it should be, because registration has final say. Actually, ultimately, the director has final say. But we make recommendations to registration about a particular product. Keep that in mind. So the process itself. There are specialists in registration that handles, specific companies, right? I think they're divided by the companies and the submissions from the companies. So they manage the submissions and all the data, and they route them to various stations. You probably have seen the names on the packets. Get to know them. These people. You have to have conversations with them to figure out what's going on. Sometimes you need to go to them to ask them questions about the labels and things like that. Surface water, obviously, at the end of the queue, and that's traditional. We are usually there because we need reviews from chemistry station, and also we need reviews from fish and wildlife. We put those two together. it's hard to kind of do these things early. There's a been recent moves to try to facilitate getting us the data earlier from them, a draft report, for example, so we can get moving on them. So just be aware that sometimes you'll get draft Fish and Wildlife reports, but usually the numbers won't change, or the, you know, the acceptability of a study won't change. So that's just a way of facilitating and making things move faster. So the packets, when we say the packets, these are the things that I usually give to you guys. Sometimes they're in a folder, sometimes they're just on their own with clips, and they'll have cover sheets on them. The packets will contain the proposed label, okay? It will have some supporting information sometimes, like letters from registrants and papers where there's studies that are referenced, the registrants and studies that are referenced in there. Sometimes there are other evaluations. You may see some of the other evaluations from MedTox, again, Food Health Assessment. So you say MedTox. And other branches in there. So sometimes it's kind of interesting. You don't have to look at it, but you know, if you're curious what they're looking at, take a look at their memos. And of course, a routing slip or a cover slip, it basically helps with the routing. Okay. And these packets, when it comes to service, well, they come through Jackie Mays, and then what happened is she basically walked over 6 feet and drops it off my inbox. And that's where it starts. So there is a routing criteria. It's not that you guys get everything. We don't get everything. We only get a very, very small piece. And the last one was updated in 2012, I think by Sherry and by John Sanders at the time. And this is what we look at. All new AIs, okay, except these things. And what you notice once you look at this list is that these things are generally things that are like lower risk in terms of water quality, you know, the bait, some of the microbial biochemical material. I don't think this is necessarily comprehensive. There's more. So the registration also routes these kind of products to us, the ones that are directly applied to water, rice, used on rice, antifouling paints and products that basically used for objects near or above water for leaching into the water. And this is my favorite one. It's a product designated by the registration branch chief as needing revaluation. And what this means is if somebody on the outside, like stormwater program or the water board, they see a product that comes up in one of these notices from registration, they'll send an email to Ann Pritchard, the branch chief, and usually copies me and says, "Can you please review this because we have so-and-so concern?" Sometimes it's wastewater. And what happened is there's been a lot of this lately. The last few years, it's pretty much kind of doubled our workload, and a lot of you have seen these kind of products come through and have to actually review them. Some of them are like, why are we reviewing this? It doesn't make a lot of sense. And then some of them, yeah, you'll see the importance of why they're asking. There's tracking that takes place, too, by Jackie and myself. So, you know, we know where the packets are, who's reviewing them, and when they were assigned, all that stuff. I get a lot of registration folks come into my office and ask me, do you think you need to review this? Because they're not sure if it's a routing criteria. So I have to kind of look through it, think about it, and say, no, we don't need to look at this. So I'm trying to protect us from getting things that we don't necessarily need to review. So, you know, I'm fighting for you guys, so we don't have to deal with this sort of thing. We can get buried underneath these type of things. So some of the stuff makes it through. And those that make it through get signed based on oftentimes on staff background, expertise, areas. Like JT, we probably get a lot of wastewater stuff. That's their expertise. Some folks, stormwater gets that. April gets some stormwater stuff. But it's also workload because we all have other things we work on. Okay, we know that. So the how. Well, we're really focused on trying to get to the understanding, better understand the risk, the risk to of the use of the products and the consequence of that use on sensitive aquatic life. Okay. So the main question is, are the risks acceptable? And here we go again. You know, is it significant or insignificant? You know, that always kind of creeps up. So some risks are acceptable, just not up to a certain level. And there are really two methods of evaluation, model-assisted, and this is kind of one of the main reasons that we're here, because Yuzhou is going to walk us through how to work through the model. And then there's the no-model way, which I people used to say the good old days, but I don't know if that's the case. I think it's the not so good old days. It's really open-ended. We call it the best professional judgment review, right? A lot of the old-timers who've been here a while have done a lot of these. And they're not that much fun because oftentimes you get to a review and you get to the conclusion and you say, well, this, you know, toxicity looks high, but persistent is kind of, you know, not that long. And you start asking these kind of qualitative questions after a while. And then at the end you say, well, it should be okay unless there's a lot of use. I don't know how many evaluations I've seen over the years that look like that, but that isn't really, that's not very helpful. So this is why the model-assisted way is really preferred. It gives you another tool to kind of wrap your brain around. So I want to talk a little bit about the null model, the old-fashioned way, the null model approach, and then I'll let Yuzhou go into the model work. So what to do when the product cannot be evaluated through the model? And I say at this time because who knows, maybe it'll come up or one of the modelers will come up with a better way of evaluating a product or a use pattern that we haven't been able to do before. Well, okay, first, basically you verify that you can't model it. That's step number one, if you think about it. When you get a packet in, you get the product in, take a look, you think, can this be modeled, all right? So it requires that you have to read the label and get to know that product better, okay? And then you have to ask if there are registered products with similar use patterns. And stop if there is, because we have this thing here where if there's a product that's already been registered with that use pattern, you can't, it's hard to justify not registering the product you're evaluating, okay? So that should be a red flag right there if you see something that's already been registered for use. So you have to kind of know what's registered for use, right? That's the tricky part. You don't necessarily know. That's when you can talk to the reg specialist. They can give you an idea of that. Sometimes you can go to the label use database, take a look at the products that are around, click on a few that looks like they're promising, but they'll tell you how, you know, the basic label information and the use information. That's the pathway. Think about it. Is it something that's already applied directly to water? Is it a stormwater issue? Is it a wastewater issue? Some of you may not have the wastewater issue before, but we get products that we review that has a wastewater concern. Some of it may have a drip component to it. You have to think about how it's applied. Think about that way. And some of this will apply to the model. When you're trying to kind of wrap your head around the product and the use, this also works early on when you're looking, in the case of where you're going to use the model as well, because you have to understand what kind of numbers you're plugging in. You have to really know the product. Can the predicted environmental concentration of the PEC, or the EEC in some cases, expected, be estimated quantitatively? Sometimes you'd be surprised. You know, even though it's not something that you could model, maybe there's information that would tell you that maybe I would expect the peak concentration to be this much. I can give you an example again of the Vignos product, where it's actually part of the label that you're supposed to bring up a concentration of product to, what was it, 100 parts per million. That's kind of like they actually tell you. So that's information, good information right there that you can say, wait, I actually know what the concentration is supposed to be, peak concentration. So you can rely on that as the exposure part of the equation of the risk. Sometimes you can ask questions about the loading relative to other sources, because if you calculated your loading and it's way less than, say, loading from another non-pesticide source, I'm bringing up copper and silver as an example. And I think Ina reviewed something early on that was how to do copper loading from SOX, and she was able to really quantitatively go through step by step and show relative loading and say, okay, how important is this source versus other sources? That was a really good review. And basically, if your source is really small compared to some of the other sources, you can kind of say, well, you know, yeah, it's going to contribute somewhat to the wastewater load, but there are these things you can consider. And therefore, you can come up with a conclusion that would support a product. Okay. Different ways of wrapping your head around it. I'll stop saying that. It's a product used to treat articles, in treated articles. Correct it here. But the thing with treated articles is that once US EPA registers it on the federal level on that product, any state pretty much can treat articles, not the ones that have the registration in place, like ours in California, but most states can start manufacturing right away. And once that's manufactured, they can start selling these things in the routes of commerce. So you have things that are maybe the articles are treated, say, in Virginia, and these things are coming into our marketplace and being used. We haven't registered yet, but you know what? It's being used and it's perfectly legal. So when you're reviewing treaty articles, chances are you're not going to be able to deny these type of products. Okay, you can make some intelligent comments or review, or you can drill down to the details. You can have some discussion about that. But ultimately, it's hard to deny treaty articles. When we deny it here, for example, what we're denying is the use of that material to treat articles. So it's really manufacturing. This is one area that we need to work with USDPA to kind of resolve, because it's an issue. We don't really have a good way of controlling how treated articles are being used here. For wastewater, it's a treatment process, effective removal. Sometimes you can actually get information regarding removal efficiency. So if something is going through the plant and it's not really coming out the other end, the treated effluent, chances are it's either breaking down the process or it's being pulled into biosolids. We don't deal so much with biosolids, but sometimes that's okay. It's a good thing if there's effective treatment going on. Things to think about. And oftentimes I go to the Fish and Wildlife, here again, review to evaluate and assess the toxicity. In the old days, we just asked, well, you know, how toxic is it? And it's really arbitrary. And the severity of the toxicity kind of like changes over time. Because products become more toxic and toxic over time, it just seems like. So if it's below a parts per billion in terms of like an LC50 on aquatic organism, you may want to slow down and think about that, because we're getting to the point where there's a good chance that there could be some effects. Again, we're used to seeing both sides of the equation, where we're looking at the exposure and we're looking at the hazard, which is the LC50. But that should give you a clue of whether it's a problem or not. If something is toxic, say, in the parts per million or 10 or 500 parts per million, it's really not that toxic. It gives you something to hang your head on. Okay, ultimately, if you're really, really lucky, you might be able to get a crude risk quotient out of it. And I said that here, if so, if you can use a similar kind of a risk quotient approach that we use in the model. Again, you have to have the exposure and you have to have you're always going to get the most sensitive LC50 because that comes from fish and wildlife. But it's the exposure part that's usually hard for us to estimate. Okay? And if you can't have you don't have an RQ, then is there a clear case that you can make to deny the product? And if you need additional information, you can always consider conditional registration as a recommendation. But you have to have very specific idea of what you need to get, and it should get you to a more decisive endpoint. Okay. Degradant issues. This is a big thing. Are there degradant issues associated with the product you're reviewing? There may be. You may have to dig. And you're not limited to just registrant submitted data when it comes to these kind of no model approach. You're able to kind of go out there and kind of pull your own, pull the other information. Don't expand your horizon. Just make sure that you have all the information you need at hand. You can look at older evaluations. We've been doing this for a long time, so there could be some similar cases. We keep these internally and go in there and start searching for surface water and look at all the surface water review. There could be some products that are very similar that's been done before. Not saying that you're plagiarizing, but, get an idea of how somebody else handled that, how they approached it. Registrants are required to submit studies that show the identity of major degradants, which major meaning they form more than 10%. I think that's the distinction. So they can identify the degradant. Identification doesn't mean they need to give you the data you need. They may tell you, molecule A, B, and C are the major degradants, and that's it. But sometimes, if you dig deep enough, you could find, this is where you're not limited to information that's approved, you can dig into the USDPA risk assessment document. Oftentimes, there will be sections that talk about degradants, and they'll incorporate in some information such as half-life, dissipation, and occasionally toxicity data. It's case by case, it's very, it's shot in the dark, but sometimes you get lucky. And if you don't, then you kind of almost know what you need to get information you need to better evaluate the degradant. And it's still in the same vein as the regular AI, because you're still going to be asking for an idea of the exposure and also of the hazard. Again, it just kind of goes back to that whole risk equation. bottom line, I could case specific. Use your mind. You guys are all scientists, so I mean, you don't need me to tell you how to do this. It's just kind of giving you, kind of showing you the way that this is kind of the approach that it's kind of worked for in the past, and these kind of things to look out for. So, let's kind of switch over to model based, and we'll transition to Yuzhou really soon. As you know, in recent years, we developed a methodology for modeling products with certain use patterns. Okay, and you can't model everything. And it's gone through an extensive peer review by industry, by the water board, by different groups. I mean, I'm impressed that industry folks are okay with it. And that's a major step. But of course, you know, they may not like the result, right? But they're okay with the modeling approach. And it's just not static. It's continuing to evolve. You know, Yuzhou's leading the charge on this one, and it's pulling different people in, perhaps, modelers in. But the idea is that we wanted to make it better for evaluating products for use in California. The river module is like the latest update. The next one's probably going to be the degradative module. So right now, we don't have one yet, so there's the old-fashioned way of kind of thinking about it in terms of risk, but it's coming. And there'll be other changes as well. So.
Before the modeling part, I want to talk about the data properization, because the model is based on data. So this is my pyramid. As you can see, we have the foundation, which is the resident submitted the data, including both the data variables and the product label. So the submitted data could be very complex, but fortunately, we have our friends in the pesticide registration branch to review the data and provide the approved data for us to use, including both the chemistry data and toxicity data. So sometimes we call this EPR approved data. And the label could be also reviewed by the registration branch, but the results may not be have a significant effect on our own evaluation. So just to give a bypass to the model input data preparation. So as you can see, the input data preparation is basically the translation of the approved data and the product label into the model input. So it's very important, because before that we have the support from the registration branch, and after that we have the support from the model. So this is the only place you can actually change anything. So as I mentioned before, two data sources for our surface water evaluation. One is the EPR approved AI specific data, and then the product label. Then we will cover the label part, and I just focused on the AI specific data. And those approved data are not usually prepared in a hard copy, but it's available in an electronic form, which is indexed by a tracking ID number. So with this number, you can find two types of reports. One for the chemistry data, such as the POC, solubility, half-life, and the other one for the fish and wildlife toxicity data. Details for the data preparation, especially for the AI specific data, have been documented in the guideline. So you can find the guideline in your the training folder, or you can use the link I've prepared for you. So please just open the user manual and get to the appendix in the end of the user manual. So we will use that quickly. So this guideline basically answers the following questions. Where to get the data, the approved data, and how to handle the multiple versions, and which parameters are required for the modeling, and what's the general purpose, general approach, and what's the additional consideration. So the location to get the PRB report, which is located in the registration tracking system. So please use this link, or just click on the link I provided in the tracking package. So you can get into the link with your Viber browser. So please just do that. Click on the link to get to the tracking system. So login is required. Just use your own account as you log into your local computer.
There's no difference, I think.
So you've got floor, there's no password.
I can write to it.
Yeah, well, we log into the computer.
Oh,
okay. Yeah. So the only thing you have to prepare is the six digit tracking ID number. So next one is the example. So we are use this chemical as an example, because this is pretty new for most of us. And so please just follow this instruction to get into the data. And first you found the link for the evaluation history with linked reports, and then to search by the tracking ID number. And the bottom of the page you will find the links for the report, the DPR approved data there. So for the reports, we are mainly looking for two types of reports, the chemistry data evaluation, which is coded with the CE, and the other fish and wildlife with the FW. So everyone with me, you will see a screen something like this. So just to repeat the process, to find the link for the history with the linked report, and then search with the tracking ID number, which is... And then there is a summary page, which is really useful, because, for example, you can get some basic information, including the general use, even before you look into the label. So for this product, it's for the control of the various diseases for almonds, grapes, and lettuce. In addition to that, you may also get some information for the status of the evaluation report. As you can see, we already get the chemistry data, the fish and the wildlife, and there are some available data such as the work safety and environmental monitoring.
That's exciting too, because that includes groundwater and
sort of. Yeah, including both the. And for this chemical, this AI, it said it's never registered, so it's brand new. And just click into the report. So here we are going to talk about just one thing for the multiple version of the reports. So as you can see, there are three different versions of the chemistry evaluation report dated in 2012, 2013, and February and March. So what happened to those multiple versions? We just take a look. So let's start with the older version, which is in the 2012. Open that and take a look at the registration status recommendations. So it said that the data information do not support registration. So that means there must be some reason. There is maybe something missing or not acceptable. So we just go to the end of the report to find those reasons. It's usually just above the reference here. So you can say the reason for the danger of the registration is that the registration branch is looking for more data, including the storage stability and also the field dissipation. So we expect that in the next report, the registrants will submit additional data, and the registration branch will review the data until it gets fully supported. So let's just try the next one, which is February 2013. So this time it's getting better. So it said the data information supports conditional registration. So we can look into more details. It seems that the field dissipation data are supported, as mentioned here. And yeah, the status has been upgraded to acceptable. So, but at the end of this report, it's mentioned that we're still looking for another information, such as storage stability. So we can expect that the last report, the data should be supported unconditionally. So that's the reason for multiple version of the report. So here are some explanations for the reason. It's not a fresh version, but just based on my own experiences. So I saw the missing data. That means the submitted data are okay, but it's not sufficient. So the registration branch will request additional data. But for us, with surface water, we'll use both the original data and the additionally submitted and approved data. And second
reason is that as the data is totally unacceptable. So in this case, the PRB will request the verification or updating on the data. So for surface water, we will only use the approved data. And another one is that the data is totally fine, but they indicate a potential environmental risk. So in this case, we will see some requests from PRB, such as the mitigation message in the label. So, and for this case, it's not really a factor or a surface water regulation in most cases. So the next one is to determine which parameters are required for the model. The requirements are based on the general information of the use plan, such as it's a landscape-based or vegetation-based application or aquatic rice or urban. So if you don't want to look into the label, you can just use the summary page. So for example, for the product we just went through, it's mentioned that it's basically applied on the almonds, grapes, and the nettles. So that means it's a general landscape or vegetation-based application. The details in the requirements are available in the data preparation guideline table 5. So I will go to that table. And again, use the linkage here, technical reports and user's manual. And open the user's manual. It's the appendix to the user's manual here. The guideline for the data preparation for the evaluation. So the table 5 is here. So as you can see, for a general application, we require some data such as KOC, solubility, and soil half-life, field dissipation, something like that. And for some special application pattern, we require more data. For example, for the urban, for the aquatic application, we will require the aquatic dissipation half-life. And for urban, we may require even more, such as the photolysis, this half-life, vapor pressure, Henry Law constant, and so on. So for any pesticides, we also request the toxicity data, of course. Okay, so the general approach, and so now we have the we have determined which parameters are required for the model, and we also get the data report. So it's time to get all of the approved data in the report and cut into some statistics. So for example, for the chemical property, we use the median value. And for the toxicity, we use the lowest value or the median value. So that's a general purpose. That's a general approach. So, and to simplify the data calculation, I would like to suggest you take a first look at summary tables. Because our friends in the registration branch already summarized the data for us, so we just take the advantage. So in the chemistry evaluation, there are so many tables, so we need some strategy to find the summary table. So the tricky thing is that you can search by groundwater or leaching to get the summary table. It's funny, because we are talking about surface water evaluation, but we have to search groundwater. I think the reason is that the groundwater modeling has been incorporated in the data review. So that means the data review is finished, the groundwater evaluation is also finished. And for the toxicity data, there are not many tables, but just be careful, there are very similar tables for different purposes. So for us, we are looking for only the technical grade. With AI or the chemical, the pure chemical toxicity. But there might be also available for the end-use product, formulated product, and the aggregate.
So, I will.
Joe, I have a question. What do you do when you have an in-use product that's more toxic than the technical grade?
We have many previous cases for that. We still keep using the AI toxicity.
Interesting. Okay.
So, I will show some examples. And so, for example, this time I just opened the chemistry evaluation and searched for groundwater. So here shows the summary table. As you can see, For some of those parameters, there is only one data value. In this case, we can just use that single value. But sometimes we get a data range. For this case, we have to go back to the original table or the data in the evaluation report. So this is really helpful because more than half of the required parameters maybe just get the value in a single table, which is prepared in the evaluation report. And next is for the fish and wildlife toxicity data. So just open that. And it's usually in the first table because there is, yes. So as you can see, the first table is a summary of the toxicity values for the AI. So this is the data we try to use. But there might be other tables for the degraded or for, as you can see here, it's for the degraded. So don't use this one. Just keep use the AI toxicity. Additional considerations which have been documented in the guideline, I just quickly go through those considerations. So in the guideline for the data preparation, I have some highlighted considerations. For example, as mentioned before, if there is a single value available in the summary table, just use that value for the modeling. And if it's mentioned stable for the degradation half-life, you can use a very large number of the half-life, such as 999 or even higher. If the data is presented in a data range in the summary table, we have to go back to the original data to see what happens to that. Maybe there are multiple approved values. And of course, if a parameter is not summarized in the table, we also should go back to the original report. And for the half-life, if both the degradation half-life and dissipation half-life are reported, we should use the dissipation half-life. So what's the difference between dissipation half-life and the degradation half-life? Dissipation is that the total mass conversion from the parent to the degraded. And the degradation is the mass conversion from the parent compound to a specific degraded. For example, I am the parent AI. I have two daughter products, A and B. So I have five pieces of pizza. I gave four to the degraded A, and I gave one to degraded B. So my total degradation is five, but for the degraded A, the degradation is four. So that's the difference between degradation and dissipation. And next one, 3.2, is about the reliability of the approved data. So sometimes the data is approved, but it's also associated with some comments because of the regression coefficient is maybe so low. So in this case, we should contact or discuss with the registration branch to make sure we use the reliable data only. And the 3.3, if we have data under the California field condition, we just use that data. So you may have, I'm asked some questions such as if the California data value is totally different with other approved data such as from Germany or from Japan. In this case, in that case, we still use the California data. And of course, as mentioned in the general approach, we use the median value of the approved data. So for toxicity data, we use the LC15 or EC15 for the acute toxicity for both the freshwater and the saltwater. And I will mention more in the slide. So this is generated by Shane for like a summary or reference for the typical or recommended species for the toxicity test. So you may familiar with some of them, but this is first time we compile them together. So as you can see, we have freshwater sediments, saltwater sediments. So at this time, we just use the lowest value of everything in the water column, and also use the lowest value for the sediment. So as you can see, for the water column, we are considering the like 2-day EC15 or 4-day LC15. And for the sediment data, it's usually limited. So I mentioned that we should consider all available data. But if you have any concerns, just contact the team for the confirmation. And this is a summary for the AI data preparation.
So I mentioned that we only use the approved data from the registration branch. So do not use the data which is not reviewed, not approved by the DRB, even if submitted by the restaurant. In addition to that, don't just grab data from the open literature or from any other data source. We should consider that and talk with the registration branch to get approved. And also, we should consider all approved data, including those data covered across different versions of the report. And for example, for some pesticides, the QC values are available in two different reports. So you may want to get all data, not just from one report. And in addition to that, some of the properties may not be summarized. So in this case, we have to go back to the report, the main text, and other tables. For example, for the field dissertation, it's not in the summary table, but in the text. The future change. There is no major change, but we, in the near future, we may try to separate the freshwater and the saltwater system. In addition to that, because of the coming of the secondary data module, we may have to do the data preparation for both the parent AI and secondary.
I'm going to go briefly over product label, interpretation, and such. It shouldn't take that long, and then we'll go back to you, Jim. So it's really all about reading and interpreting the label, right? So what do you need? I said before, I hate labels. They're notoriously hard to read and decipher, right? But, you know, you're not alone. We all have to kind of deal with sort of thing. So there's, you know, there's almost like peer support groups. Just come and talk together, give each other a hug and all that stuff. The key is you need to mine for critical pieces of information. Labels, very small print, pretty dry. Some of it seems redundant. Some of the parts of it don't make a lot of sense. It's not your fault. You know, EPA says it's fine. Somebody at EPA can read it, so they say it's okay. But do make sure that you have the latest label. Sometimes you'll have different versions. You'll have multiple, like proposed label, and then new proposed label, and then newer proposed label. So keep in mind, check with the registration specialist. They'll be able to give you the latest label. Sometimes things change as it comes to the queue. Do a quick read. I know it sucks. But you gotta do a quick read of the entire label, okay, from the beginning to the end, because there's sometimes there are morsels that are tucked in places that you don't think should be there, but they are there. So some considerations. It does help to make a copy of what they provide in there. That way you can just scribble and label and highlight away. Generally, it's okay to kind of write little notes here and there on the original, but you know if you intend to be a slasher and go in there and do all these things, go ahead and make a copy. For the new AIs, just look at all the proposed uses because they're all just kind of new uses, right? And you can think about what the product's for. But for label amendments and for products of registered AIs, that's a new product that you have to look at, whether it's flagged before or somebody on the outside asks us to review it, you'll need to look for the new or identify the new uses. That's tough, but you have to do that. You can go back to the previous label for label amendment, for example, you can go back to the previous label and you can see what was there. When you look at the new label, you can see where the new use has been added. That's the way to identify it. Then you want to kind of key in on some of the various commodities or use sites that can be modeled. You have a good idea right away. Sometimes products are just urban. You'll be looking at some of the urban sites of uses, whether it's residential or commercial, industrial, to start sort of keying in on those areas. Try to look into the highest rate of applications, the uses with those the highest rates. Those may be the one that you would want to model. If you have time or it's not too complicated and it's not a big deal, you model all of them if you can. But in some cases, it's really obvious that you may have multiple uses. But this rate is way high, so you may want to key in on that one. I think the way you recommend a manual is to basically do all that you can, and then kind of sort throughout later. You can do that too. So here's a list of the information you're going to need for the input, and this is pretty much kind of verbatim to what you're seeing on in the model on the interface. Okay, max rate of single application, no-brainer, right, pretty basic. The intervals, minimal intervals, days, usually between the applications. The maximum number of applications per year or growing season. In some cases, a growing season may not be just one in a year. Ina just had a case where it's, you know, we're looking at some of the crops in the central coast. Well, growing season there is two. So that may change how the way you look at certain crops are too. Okay. So you may have to look in the growing season if that becomes an issue. The date of the first application is available to put in there. I haven't seen a case where this is used yet. Otherwise it's essentially just assumed that the beginning of the season is the beginning of the year. And the last item here is the maximum annual application amount. So you see that occasionally comes up. But most times, folks will try to focus in on the preferred information as the more simple application, more detailed. Beware of the rate units, okay, because it's not always going to come out in what's a kilogram per hectare. Oftentimes, they're in something else. You have to make sure you use the right rate. And there's a rate calculator that's embedded in there, which is really useful. Additional label info. For the urban uses, in the current module, the urban module, there's like a pop-up that will ask you specifically whether the product is residential, industrial, commercial, or a rights-of-way. They'll even ask you, you know, is it granular or liquid? The method of application, this is, you know, perimeter spray, broadcast, crack and crevice. And I think right now the model allows for some adjustments to the effective application rate, okay? But I usually, unless it's a good reason, it's the default. Yeah. There's a default for a reason.
So we quickly go through the methodology before the demonstration. So again, the technical reports, which is available online, or also in your training folder. And the general purpose is to develop a more consistent and transparent method for the evaluation compared to our previous method, which is based on the best professional judgment. So the model is originally developed for organic compounds, but may be used for other chemical specialist methods. And it's developed for the pesticide applications with runoff potentials to surface water bodies. So the application could be on the ground surface, on concrete or vegetation, or even a water surface, such as the rice pesticide. So I'd like to mention the intentional application and the unintentional application. The difference is that intentional application means that I really want to apply the pesticide to reach the surface or to reach the vegetation. But the unintentional application means that the context of the pesticide to the ground or to the vegetation is not my purpose, but it happens. So mathematically, the difference is that for intentional application, we just use the label rate, as mentioned in the product label. But for the unintentional application, we have to do some adjustments according to the overspray or its deprivation. We have to, in most cases, to reduce the label rate. I will have an example for that.
So, of course, the model is developed based on scientific considerations, which have been documented in the technical report. But today, I only focus on the additional considerations, which is very specific to EPR or to our surface water, which may or may not be scientific. So, for example, the model is developed according to the availability of the EPR approved data, or actually for the US EPA data requirement. So that means we have to use a model or connect a model which uses the data we do have. So for example, there is a good example for that. So US EPA has a model for the SWIM SWMM stormwater management model, which is really good for the urban evaluation or for the urban risk assessment. But it's never used for the registration evaluation because the model uses a totally different system of the input parameters. So the commonly reported parameters such as QC, solubility, half-life are never used by that model. That's the reason. Even if it's a very nice model, but it's not used for our purpose. And we also consider the previously well accepted the data analysis by surface water program. For example, we use the median or average POC, use the lowest toxicity value. But this is not always true for other agents. For example, US EPA never used such kind of statistics. And we also consider the indicators and factors frequently used in our previous evaluation. For example, even before we had a model, we're talking about the high toxicity or no runoff potential, something like that, so we will keep using them. And the model showed that generated some registration recommendations and additional data requests, which can be understood by our surface water and the DPR staff. And the model should generate consistent results compared to the previous evaluated package post the evaluation results. So we don't want to make any surprise.
And there's the procedure for the model development, which is started from April 2010.
And after that, we have a stage one, stage two. But before it's called phase one, phase two, I use stage because phase is sometimes used for the chemical phase, such as the chemical dissolved phase or unsolved phase. So I use stage one, stage two. After that, we have additional modules. For example, urban module has been posted, and the diagonal module is finished and under review. And we have the receiving water module under development.
The first two stages are called the main program, which is used generally to capture or catch up with the US EPA evaluation. But those modules are something about, beyond the US EPA, because when the US EPA functionality is not available or not suitable for California field condition, we will develop our own modules. And there are some laws for the receiving water body. So the definition is like this. We're talking about surface water evaluation. We need a location for the evaluation. We have different candidates. For example, we can have the evaluation in the agriculture field or in the irrigation retained water or in a small creek, Sacramento River, Bay Delta, or even the Pacific Ocean. US EPA suggested that we use the receiving water, which is the water body adjacent and connected to agriculture fields, which can also apply it to the urban condition, for example, like a retention pond connected to a residential community. So US EPA have suggested a standard farm pond, which has been accepted by both US EPA and the restaurant very much, but it's not suitable for California field condition. That's why we have a new study, the DPR study 293, conducted by ENA, and we try to get a California specific scenario for the receiving water body. But before we had that scenario, we kept using the US EPA pumps. And as you can see, for the new development of those additional modules, this has been incorporated. And for the agricultural use, we will consider the US EPA pumps if the original model, I mean the phase one and the phase two, gave a Daniel recommendation. And of course, once our own module is developed, we will keep using that and replace any of those US EPA pumps. And the pyramid again. So now we have data prepared. After that, everything, including the generation of the indicators and the final recommendations, are actually conducted by the model. So I just give a quick review on that. The five indicators. So you should all familiar with those indicators, such as the runoff potential, persistent use pattern, and the risk quotient. Those are data we prepared from the restaurant branch approved the data and from the label. And then we use sometimes it's a simple approach or sometimes complex model to generate those indicators, which are expressed in a category format, such as a high persisting or no persistent, something like that. It's not really expressed in a numeric format. And the first three indicators are actually based on the AI specific data. And the next two are also considered the product specific information. As a two stage evaluation, the stage one initial screening will only based on the first three parameters, which are based on the AI specific data. So the results of the stage one could be supported directly or need additional evaluation in stage two. And this sentence just answers the question why we need a phase one when the more complex phase two is available. So the reason is that there is a significant portion of the pesticides of AI which can be reach phylo recommendation even without additional consideration in phase two. That's the reason we still keep using the stage one. And stage two refined modeling will based on the next two indicators, including the use pattern and the risk quotient.
and which are mainly from the product and label information. And this is a decision-making flowchart as mentioned by Nan. So as you can see, we have five indicators. If all of them are high, we just get a Daniel for the registration, and those are the registration recommendations. In addition to that, we also have a watch list. And please note that those recommendations are for the product, but the watch list is for the AI. And then we'll cover more information about those recommendations and our watch list. And recently, I'm asked several times by the difference between the round extension and the juice panel, especially by our new staff. So I want to mention that here. So the difference is that the round potential is basically a chemical property, which is determined by the solubility, QC, and field dissipation. So that means even a chemical is not really used as a pesticide, but it can be associated with a high or no round potential. But the use pattern, according to the exposure risk, is totally defined by the product label. So for example, for the same AI, you can use the AI in the agriculture field or use as the base station. So obviously the agricultural pesticide will have a higher exposure risk compared to the indoor use. And this page is for a list of the use patterns with high exposure risk. For example, we have aquatic application including rice and urban residential with a significant application to the impervious surfaces. So as you can see, urban is not the keyword. Impervious surface is the keyword. And we also consider the crops with a significant gravity-based irrigation, such as furrow irrigation and flood irrigation. And we consider the winter season application, such as the dormant season application, and of course the pre-emergent application.
Joe, could you explain what 50% greater than 50% means?
Means that the DWR, Department of Water Resource, have a survey for the irrigation type. So they, for each of the crops, they have a percentage of the furrow irrigation, percentage of the flood, percentage of the sprinkler, and so on. So I just use that survey results to determine which crops are associated with larger than half of the total irrigation use. Those five categories of the high-risk use pattern are actually defined even before my employment in EPR. During the development of the model, we also get some comments from the registration branch. They suggested that we should consider the crops with top acres, including the top plant acres and the top treated acres in California. So we buy this point. And recently, we also identified that nursery could be a problematic use panel. So this will be included in the next version. And the high-risk use patterns are specified in the model, so it's very clear for most of those. The only problem, the only thing I'm asked several times is about the field crops. So here I gave the DWR definition for the field crops in California. So please keep in mind that only those crops are considered as a field crop, so don't just add any more by yourself. And this is the model evaluation. We did a back testing by using the model to our old or previous evaluation based on best professional judgment. So as you can see, this model generally gave a consistent result. This is a good thing. So after that, we applied the model and officially in the evaluation. The first product to be modeled is conducted in October 2011, so it's already 3 years old. And during that period, we have 83 packages evaluated by surface water. About half of them are nothing to do with models, such as data review, method review, or PWG reports. So those are nothing to do with models. But we have 44 new AIs or new labels, which potentially to be evaluated by a model. Actually, we get three-quarters of them modeled with the registration evaluation model. And for your information, there are only two of them are not supported by the model, including the Foxcub and Pilot Enterprise. 11 of those new AIs or new labels are not really modeled because of their chemistry, their use, or both of those reasons, including the inorganic metals and microbial pesticides, some other different new tenants, which is not currently covered by the model. But we, for the next step of the model development, we may cover some of those use tenants. For example, the indoor use and methods may be covered by the next version of the model. In other models, so I want to mention we have a more model in addition to this surface water evaluation. So the first one is the US EPA active disk model, which is designed for actually for the unintentional application, such as those with significant deposition to agricultural fields. So we have an example, which is a product containing ecofilm products labeled as the mosquito control over the agriculture field. So our air program helped us to predict, use the ArcGIS model to predict the percentage of the applied AI with the deposition to the surface. So in this case, as mentioned before, for unintentional application, we have to adjust the labeling. So this is adjusted for our labeling. After that, we can just follow our regular evaluation program. And we also have the model called MAMPEC, which is designed for the unfolding product. So I don't have an example for the evaluation, but the modeling scenario has been defined by Shihan and Nan. Do we use that in a real evaluation? Okay, the model demonstration. So at first, please locate the model in your the training folder. There are two files and one folder, and two files for the data and the program, and the folder is for the modeling scenarios. So please just double click on the exe file to open the interface. So sometimes you may get information for the updating of the program, but maybe not today. So in this case, you just copy the new version and replace your old one. After that, if there is a new version, can I just keep my old data I have been working on for a while? I said yes, to just save that data, and I can do the data transfer for you. And I have three exercises. One is to add a new AI, then a simple test, and urban evaluation. So before that, let me just take a quick look at the interface. So there are basically two payloads. The upper payload is for the data for the chemical for the AI, and the lower payload is for the use information, the label information. So you can just select one of those the chemicals I prepared for the demonstration purpose, and then the chemical property and the toxicity data will be populated in this grid displayer. So in this case, you can make any change. For example, you can change this inductible point to, you can change that to 0.3, but just make sure you see the change.
I want to add something right now too, Yuzhou, because sometimes people go in there and they change it for whatever reason, silly reason, and the next person goes in and says, this is when you need to go back, take a look at the data and make sure it just correct. Don't always assume that it's correct.
Oh, yeah.
Easy to do that. It's not the way you should do it. It does take work, but you need to go in and look at each number and see that those are correct. Because it will make a huge difference. It could make a huge difference in the model.
Yeah, that's very important. Just make sure that the data in the database is really correct.
So is the same result, the values were actually stored in the local computer?
Yeah, for this version, we use a local copy. But
later on, if you want to run another model, if you open the window again, the value that you
just once it's in your local computer.
Yeah, it's mainly a problem when we're still sharing the version
yeah.
on the shared drive. And I don't know if in the future it's never going to be like that.
Maybe. So there is an option. So in the drop-down menu, there is an option called Add a New Chemical. So just use that for the next demonstration exercise. So it asks you to provide with a chemical name. You can just give any name you want.
And the data for the new chemical are listed here. So please just go ahead and get your new chemical. Okay, so just make sure you save your change on the new chemical. So once you have the new chemical, go ahead for the next exercise, a simple test. So use the chemical you just created. And then say next use Pantone of the almond. Application data is very simple, just 1.26, and there is only one application per year. So in this case, you have two options. You can use the option of based on maximum annual application to get the 1.26, or you can specify the multiple application, but just use one of the number of the application. I think both options should be the same result. And then click run to get the result. Then you should get something like this. So this is the modeling. It's a summary for both the model input and output. So as you can see, the input number one, the chemical property and the environment state data. Input number two, the processing data. Number three, use hand and use weight. And then the model will report the five indicators. As you can see, the use pattern, raw potential, persistence, persisting, risk exposure, and then the final recommendation. So in this case, it's called watch, and more explanation here. The data information supports conditional registration, and the AI will be placed in the watch list for the future monitoring. And so as you can see, it's not just a demonstration, it's a real evaluation, which is currently working on by Dan. So hopefully, but this is just one a single model simulation. Maybe the real evaluation need more model simulation. But anyway, well, hopefully this won't affect Dan's evaluation results. And next thing, the urban evaluation. So the urban module is recently developed, so there is no real posted official evaluation package in our internal web set. So I just used an example. It's also a real example, actually, I'm currently working on. This is for the induced carbon-based pesticide with a month application to pave the area. So the data are mainly generated by Calvin in his previous evaluation. So I already prepared the data in the program, so you can just select that from the menu. Yeah. And then you select the use panel as the urban uses. So for the monthly application, we use 12 applications in a year with a 30-day interval. And then you can set your own data for the fourth application. It doesn't matter because it's monthly application. If you can change that to the second day or third day, it should not be a significant. This time it will take a little bit longer time because of the multiple surface in the organ.
Is it a liquid or a granule?
Yeah, that's the next step.
Sorry.
Here. So more information for urban evaluation. Those information are required for the urban only. So just as in the application method and use the update option to get a suggested fraction of those treated areas. And then here you can make any change as mentioned by Nan. If you have a specific reason to make a change, just do that. Otherwise, just keep using the suggested or default value. So as you can see, I have different options. For the parameter treatment, you can specify the application band for the ground and for the vertical wall.
But how would you read this on a label? Like, how does it come up on a label? So say application on endurance versus
never
seen. Because I've seen perimeter, and in the regs we have correctness set at the spot. But how would we know just application on paved areas is kind of general?
If there is no information for the width of the application band, I think we can just give a worst case scenario by assuming that it applies to the entire paved area.
And actually, this part is really powerful because you can make any changes on the treated fraction. So, for example, the Syngenta said that in addition to the impervious surface, they also considered sort of the 12% of the residential turf. So that means you can have a totally control on this part to mimic any kind of application.
Yeah, something real quick too. You know, on the 201 house scenario that I'm talking about, there's an assumption, and it's a pretty conservative assumption, that all the houses are being applied to this material at final paint. That's not really as true in real life. That's ridiculous, but that's something that we're looking at. Looking at survey data from PWG, you know, the Perico, and some of you've seen it. And somehow maybe we could adjust that type of application rate or factor to make it more realistic. But right now, it's
Be aware. And adding to that, in our model, we assume that 100% of the application, I mean, the 100 of the entire community will receive the pesticide control. But in the PWG urban use data survey, they suggested another percentage, which is 75%. Compared to 100%, it's not that bad.
So I think you already get the results updating summit. So this time, in addition to the summary of the input output, the model also reported additional data, which is the impound concentration. So this is used for two major purposes. One is that if the registered run want to take a look at original modeling results, we can just provide this to them. In addition to that, it's also used for the model developer to make sure the feature change, such as our California scenarios for the redeeming water. But anyway, go back to the summary of the modeling results. As mentioned before, this time the risk quotient is reported as a numerical value because the concentration is actually available at a daily time step. And the final recommendation is that the data information does not support registration. That's the demonstration is done. Okay, so go ahead for the reporting part.
Okay, now you have the model recommendation. Now what? You're not done yet. Sorry. You still have to put things in perspective. The model is just kind of help you think about what you're working with, okay? An example is a clipper aquatic herbicide, another one of Kevin's fun ones. He's been getting a lot of fun ones the last couple of years. Flumioxazin is the AI. And in that case, the model says it's an aquatically applied herbicide, but the model says we'll say conditional. Well, okay, fine. So you have the recommendation, but think about it for a second. We looked into the degradation data and the half-life data. Stuff breaks down in less than a few hours in the water. So what's going on? So you should be thinking about degradation because if it breaks down quickly, it means degradation are forming quickly. We looked at the degradation. Turns out that the half-life of degradants are quite a bit longer than the parent, which means it's going to be existing in degradant form for a while. So in that case, we end up having issues, and we don't know enough about the toxicity of the degradant, so we ended up making it, we denied. And said, you know, we deny until you guys give us more information about the degradant, I think the dissipation, blood dissipation, and also the toxicity data. So again, the model says something, doesn't mean you have to believe it, okay? You still have to think about the use of the product as a whole. And you still have other concerns. Again, it's a case-specific thing. You're going to have to figure that out in looking at the product. You may need additional data. The degradation thing was a good example of that. You may need information that doesn't quite fit. You know, hopefully, with the modeling already done, you use the needed data to address the AI, but there may be some degradation questions that you need to ask. Sorry. Can the overall modeling be improved? You just brought up the example with Zenovex. This is one of Kay's evaluation. We had to get creative. The material is applied as sort of almost like a fog,
but the label says you're applying it over an ag area. Well, hey, we can model the ag deposition on the ag area because we have the model that we use, the Regival model. So think outside the box. Sometimes you can actually, you know, take the result of another model, in this case ag disc, and apply it to our model. So what does support mean? Means generally the risk for aquatic systems are generally acceptable. And I'm using this as an example. Generally, this is a case where everything's kind of low. You know, low toxicity, low soil runoff potential, low persistence, and really a low risk use pattern. And RQs are generally going to be equal to or less than 0.5. And in this case, usually registrants are happy. In case of the deny, and of course, risks are not acceptable. And these are for cases often where the aquatic toxicity is high or very high, the runoff potential is high, AI is pretty persistent, and the high risk use pattern, the ones that you would click down that menu and select, that's a high risk use pattern. RQs are above 0.5, and this is when we start getting into this whole rebuttal thing. And some of you have been involved in that, where there'll be a series of letters sent, you know, registration will send the kind of a notice. Saying, okay, your product has, if they agree, assuming that they agree with our recommendation, that's been denied for this reason. And then it will start a series of back and forth. Hopefully we'll resolve the issues. You know, there's going to be some way to remedy that, whether it's, they'll talk about submitting additional data, perhaps it's label changes. They have offered, they've been offering more label changes as an option more recently. Particularly when there's cases where it's consistently being evaluated by us and USDA, maybe a little bit easier to get a new label redone. Or in a weird case with this one we're working on, a company sold the rights of the product to a new company, and they now have to submit that new label to USDA. So there's an opportunity for them to submit a new label. So it's a little bit different, a slightly easier scenario for them to work through. conditional, I just say usually for the cases are kind of like in between those two, you know, the bracket that's bracketed by the support and the does not support. And usually it's the cases where things are just like high, very highly toxic, but it's not persistent. So, or, you know, it's not persistent, but there's a high risk use pattern, or high, very high, highly toxic, but persistent, but a low risk use pattern. So it's not one of the ones that you can use on a drag down menu. These are the cases where oftentimes conditionals come out. And it just says that the materials could move to off-site. Registrants usually have mixed feelings about this because they say, oh, good, it's registered. Because a conditional means that they can still use the sell the products in California. Folks can use it, but there's still a condition that's attached to it, and they have to address that condition within a certain amount of time. And at the same time, if the AI gets placed on what we keep hearing is this watch list. And on the flow chart, you see the watch list. So that's automatic. If it's conditional, it goes on the watch list. And what's also automatic for that is the request for the water and sediment method. A lot of you have seen that. It's like a little cookie cutter language. And remember, you know, because it's conditional, like the example I brought up with the clipper, we can still deny. Okay, so. You can also add additional conditions for it's already conditional. So this is an opportunity if you feel like you need additional information to think to wrap your head around. Maybe you ask for some degradation-related data, okay? Like the commonly asked for the degradation data, and I usually feel it's aquatic dissipation or aquatic tox data. And aquatic tox could be water column or it could be sediment as well, depending on, you know, the evaluation. We didn't really go too much into like the sediment phase in terms of like the modeling demonstration, but that's possible too. It depends on the KOC of the compound, because if it's high enough, like above 1,000, I think it triggers a sediment module. So basically, you have to basically fill information on that one. One thing the registrations asked me, Branch has asked me, is that they want us to add specific time allowance, like what Richard said, for data submission. So you may want to give them 6 months, a year, whatever, depending on what you're asking for. It should be reasonable. But that helps them to frame, to basically take that information and put it in their notice to the registrant. So, for example, please submit data within 6 months of the date of this notice. This notice is the one that the registration branch is sending to the registrar.
But do we have criteria set up for that? I mean, if it's,
no.
I mean, how do you know what's reasonable?
What's reasonable? If they have to conduct studies, if they have to do new things, that may take more than a few months or 6 months or 7 months. Maybe a year would be more reasonable. This is when you can consult people. You can consult the registration specialist. You can talk to the folks in the registration branch, and they can help guide you with that because they have a better idea of the time frame. Good question, though. Getting close to the end. So what's flagging? If the first products with a new AI are very high, are highly toxic, or have a high runoff potential, are persistent, but the use patterns are categorized as low risk. In the past, a good example would have been seed treatments. Then we would add a flag. It falls into this category of what's something we should flag, because we are concerned. The first three with the toxicity, runoff potential, and the persistence. So. But the use that's being allowed right now or being proposed for registration is low risk. So you can't really gauge actual effects on the product that may have a high risk use pattern. So this is why we flag it. This is the trend, you guys. This is happening a lot more. Registrants know that they're going to see if they can squeeze in a simple and easy product that will get approved, and then perhaps they'll slip in another new use, an additional use, or a mental label, for example. If we just ignore that, then those subsequent products could be the problematic one that we missed. And Fipronil was an example of something like that, where we saw it early, we flagged it, but there was some issues with the flagging and following up. It became a big part of the market. Now we know with the model monitoring data what's going on with Fipronil. So this is why we flag. And when you flag it, we add this additional box. In the memo, you guys know that there's a support that's not support conditional. We would add another box to it, this flag. April has done this recently. And you add the, you also add something in the conclusion that says to the evaluation folks to please flag this item. And it will go into some sort of a system. I think Eileen Mahoney, I know for sure, kind of a gatekeeper of that. And if they see a next product that has the next product, it doesn't really matter what use, they'll go ahead and drop to us. Nivaluron was an example of that April just worked on. So this is an example of the box, and then kind of the language that's real basic that you put in there. Yeah. So the low risk for runoff.
Okay, so
that's why.
Model it as a low
runoff potential. There's the other box in the interface, and then I think the outcome, the output would actually say flag for visualize, flag the AI, right?
Yeah.
So technically, you can model it, but you instead of using a high runoff pattern, you would click the part that says low runoff pattern, which in this case it would be.
So for this case, the flagging is equivalent to conditional support.
I would not recommend the model the base station. Because when we're talking about a high risk or no risk use, and we are actually talking about the condition with associated with the runoff potential. Even a high runoff potential or low runoff potential. But for the base station, I don't think there is any potential for runoff or water. Even indoor use or outdoor base, so that means it's all of the high or no classification. It's not a part of the model.
But you can even without the model, you can tell if you can kind of classify the toxicity, for example, because, again, that's an EPA classification. You can just go in and look at the number and look at the classification of the EPA and say, oh, that's very highly toxic. So it's something that's not that toxic, but it has, like, a bait use. You may not want to flag it if that's the case. I mean, it becomes more – that's in those kind of cases where it's hazy, come and talk to me, and then we'll talk to you, Joe, and we'll figure it out.
Could you add that as part of the model, as far as, like, no runoff and so on?
Once you've created that, it's very good information. So,
yeah,
okay.
Stop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, one more thing to make sure it's right. So, this cannot be evaluated by the model, but we can still, like, use the low runoff potential or low exposure rate options from the model to determine the toxic and the runoff potential and the
persistence. Yeah, well, any indicators associated with only the chemicals, specifically, you know, we can.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, this is anything with the chemicals.
Okay.
No matter if it's a pesticide that works for any use, it's a chemical.
And so, in this case, if the model says it's going to be conditional support, that would be going to the pesticide.
It wouldn't be conditional. Conditional and flagging are two different things.
Right.
Condition means that the registrant has to provide you something within a time frame and some kind of data. And flagging means that nothing may ever happen. If they don't come in with uses that major new uses, you would never see it again probably. Yeah. And so it's just a flag that says if you get major new uses, then you guys should see it. The reg specialist or the reg scientist should say, oh, we have a major new use. This needs to go to surface water, and they need to model it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if the
We should route that to you.
Yeah.
A major new use, any major new use like that should be routed to you.
Okay, even though it wasn't in the flag.
Even if it wasn't flagged.
Yeah, the new AI is going to come through our.
But I can see it. I can see it when we're trying to put in the same thing if they have plans for AI.
We are seeing that. That is a graphic common practice. And when I work with Anne, the branch chief administration, and David, to see if we can come up with another way of trying to catch these things, because some things are getting through that we're not seeing.
It's been an ongoing problem, and we in Fish and Wildlife have the same problem, where they'll have some little use, and then they come in with something major where there's a potential for non-target effects, and it doesn't get routed to it. So I think the idea of a flag is a good idea, but it still means that somebody has to catch it. But in theory, they're supposed to be caught anyway. No major new users should go through the system without somebody looking at it.
Okay. So let me blow through this. I have like a couple of slides left, and then you can open up for questions too. Okay. So this is more about the actual reporting part, the physical part. And, you know, I said see the template in a user manual. I added some template language into a user manual. We used to have these example templates in a shared drive. And what I'm finding out is that, I don't really want to tell people this is how you have to write it. And you have to follow this by the T. The idea is that you take the blank memo template that's in the shared drive, and you stick with certain types of a format. Okay, so I'm not trying to micromanage how you write, but I want to see certain types of the format that goes in there in certain sections. Person's background, basic information on the product, AI, the label they use, the pest sometimes, which company is submitting it. And maybe there's some additional information that we need to know, like, okay, this has been an ongoing review, and we've had, previous evaluation memo dated this, and it says that, and the previous memo that says this, and it says that, and the registrant responded on this date and says that. That's kind of information that we want. Set the stage. We want to see get the context and get the perspective on what we're looking at. Evaluation, that's really the meat of it, right? So, you either go into it to figure out if it's going to be, you can do the model, use the model or not. And more importantly, explain and justify what you did for the various model input. Anything important should be discussed here. Some things that may not be important to the model itself, but it's important to the discussion of the products that come out. Degradis, for example, that's a good one to start talking about in there. A lot of folks have been doing this format where they put the tables for the physical chemical properties in there, aquatic tox for a bunch of species. You don't need to do that. I know it's habit, but you don't need to do that. Just because it's going to appear later on in the appendix. You're going to take those that output files that you guys saw on the demonstration. You just print that out, and it just goes into the tunnel. You don't print it out necessarily. You append it as part of the appendices. Okay. But if there are multiple products, Science and Opro was a good one that Kay had done. There's a bunch of them. A summary table is good. Which product they are, what type of use pattern they are for, what the application rates for, and whether what the decisions were, conditional, support, or whatever. The conclusion, it should be pretty short, pretty brief. It just presents your recommendation. Remember, but if the model says something, it doesn't mean you have to stick with that, but usually that's the case. So the idea is, what are the consequences of this recommendation? Does the registrants have, are they okay with support, they don't have to do anything? It is conditional. What do they have to provide? You have to be very specific. What kind of, if you're asking for tox data, it's conditional. What species are you looking for? Are you looking for an acute test, a chronic test, usually acute? Be very, very specific. The idea is, even if it's denied, you want to provide them some guidance about how they can rectify the situation and maybe fix that. Nothing worse than just say, deny, and then nothing else. Well, what can we do? Okay, give them some hints, give them some clues about what certain things that they can submit that would help with a better approval, not a better approval, but a better outcome for them. And maybe there isn't one, and that's fine too. The reference section is pretty self-explanatory, including all things like the registrant submitted studies and other evaluations sometimes. But the fish and wildlife and chemistry always seem to, I think that's pretty bread and butter, they always pop up in the reference section. Open literature. Appendices, again, this is the model, we call the raw model input or output. And they oftentimes there's a whole bunch, it's not just one. You're lucky if you only do one, but oftentimes there'll be more than one. Pet peeve, remember, change this MU per kilogram to the actual, you know, letter. It's just the limitation in the software.
Yeah.
It doesn't do that.
Yeah.
So what I get is, you know, when Keen sees it or David sees it, they get a little irritated when they see that. So I have to always catch that, and sometimes I'll let you know, please change that. It comes up in the output as a part of the sediment input, right?
The KOC. That's because the text format doesn't accept the view.
I know. It can do all these amazing things, but yet it can't do that. And what I do when I get the output, I try to play around with it with the output file to kind of highlight certain things, you know, whether it's to bold the use pattern, because the way it's just a bunch of, you know, numbers and letters, but if you could do something to kind of help draw our attention to, like, the actual recommendation on the bottom. Italicized, it's bolded, or something like that. It's kind of useful, and there's a whole bunch of them to look through. The rates, because the rates are often different for each one, highlight the rate, so it helps the reader. And I try to put each of the input-output file into one page. That way it's easy to kind of follow. Okay, one page is one product. Flip it over. That's the next page. That's another product. But another model run.
Before you go ahead, this should be a MUG change to the UG.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
G. On the tips on the report, before you start and throughout, if you get stuck, consult Yuzhou or myself so we can help you out and, you know, make sure you don't waste your time doing something that you don't need to do. It's good to consult previous evaluations because a lot of folks have done this before. It's not the first time. Consult your peers. I talk to Rich a lot over the years when I have issues or concerns about, you know, toxicity, ecotox, aquatic tox. It's been just indispensable. Chemistry folks, I talk to them a lot too to understand better, okay, why did you approve that study? What was the problem? You need to talk to people to better understand some of the issues associated with these products. Of course, the user manual and the methodology documents that are in the same location on the external website. When you want to understand why things are done the way they are, go through that methodology. Ultimately, you know, is your evaluation clear? Is it logical? Does it make sense? I mean, you have to kind of, like, think about it in the big picture, too.
and that would it stand up to scientific scrutiny? Because if you deny something and it's conditional, even if you support something and somebody doesn't agree with that support, they're going to come to us with questions, and we're kind of obligated to kind of respond to that. So we want to make sure that we do the good work right up front and not have to kind of backpedal and say, oh, well, you know, that's not how I want to do things. For me, for my sake, and for David's sake, please proofread your draft before, mainly for my sake, proofread your draft for submitting it to me. There's some typos sometimes, and there's a lot of weird little mistakes in there. I read a ton of documents all the time, so it'd be nice if it'd be easy to kind of review. I'm just kind of pleading with you, my personal little plea. I would appreciate that. And remember, your memos are seen by a lot of people. Hope folks seem to understand that. Stormwater people, water boards, registrants definitely see that. Folks on the outside can actually ask for the documents through public information requests and see it. And it's done regularly now. So, you know, the next day after it's posted, I'm getting phone calls from people on the outside. So, you know, just so you know that if these are, you know, whatever you write in there is very, it's being seen by a lot of people. And procedurally, so when you're done, when you get the approval from David, the top section of the memo, you know, that part, try to fill out as much information as you can. Sometimes you can't provide the information, but document numbers, all the various ID numbers, USEPA reg number is not a big deal, but try to just make sure that's clear. Make sure you check the appropriate box or boxes, right? When I say boxes, it's because sometimes it could be support and flag. But it should match what you're saying in your conclusion. There should not be two different things. That would be very confusing. Once David approves, it's automatically sent to registration via email. Okay, it's instantaneous. So after that happens, I'll let you know, or sometimes you're copied. Go ahead and sign the original memo, make 3 additional copies, and then put them back in the packet. And then you fill up the status sheet on there, okay? And then you give all that to Jackie. Jackie. So then she handles it from there. And what happens after that, I will work with Kay, the person who posts our internal emails. I work with her directly. We'll send her the file. So please post this one, and it goes on, and you'll see your memo on there.